The Boreal Owl is a red-backed vole specialist. I'm giving him little tidbits of meat. Today it's quail. Make it a nice positive experience, which so far it looks like he's at least not having an unhappy time. It's hard to know how happy they are. Any questions?
Does he fly around out here?
Not out here, but he's got an indoor-outdoor enclosure. And it's, 10 feet long. And so he does fly around a lot, especially at night, you know, owl things. Mm-hmm. So he is fully flighty. He's just got the eye issue.
Did he fly into the window because his eye was damaged to begin
with? No, he flew into the window because birds fly into windows, and then it damaged his eye. And he was found not emaciated, but pretty dang thin by the time somebody came across him. So he was down to 120 grams. A gram is about a large paperclip, so 120 large paperclips. And when we picked him up from rehab at the Raptor Center, he was up to an obese 190 grams. And today he is 178. So he's still a little on the chunky side, but that's okay because it's below zero. How old is he? Oh, I should have read my bird's ages before I had you all come in here. I'm going to go about 5 years old, give or take a year. I don't remember. I used to have all my birds' age memorized, and then I had kids, and they got older, and the birds got older, and it was just a lot.
What causes an eruption for them?
What causes owl eruptions? That is the $10 million question. I can give you the naturalist speculation without really knowing 100% how accurate it's going to be. We know that the boreal, the hawk owl, and the great grays tend to come down in eruptions together. The boreal owl is a red-backed vole specialist. All three of those owls are vole specialists, but the boreal owl is the one that is most specialized in what they do. The red-backed vole seems to go in a 3 and 4 year population boom-bust cycle. We see that the eruptions tend to happen on the low numbers of the vole population, so when they're at their bust year, then the owls come down. So the speculation is, the year before when they're having that boom year, the owls produce a ton of offspring because there's lots of food, and the next year there's a lot more owls and a lot less food. And the owls that we generally see, not exclusively, but generally see pushing south in the eruptions happen to be young owls like he was. He was at the beginning of his second year when he pushed south. We think the adults can probably eke out a living up in the boreal forest during those low vole numbers because they know the best spots and they're very experienced hunters. But the juveniles have to get up and leave. We used to think the owls were starving when they came down. And we certainly do have a few individuals that do die of starvation. But from raptor banders, we know that the vast majority that are captured and tagged and banded, their body condition is good. So it doesn't appear to be starvation is moving them south, which doesn't exactly correlate with everything that we were thinking, so there might be another missing puzzle piece yet. Not certain, but that is where the science is right now.
He was hatched 2012.
You looked it up? Mm-hmm. 2012 hatcher. Ow.
He's so cute.
He's getting his beak trimmed tomorrow.
COVID.
Every 4 months we trim his beak, and tomorrow we have a vet appointment for that. And then this Saturday he's going to be up at Saxon Bog teaching for the birding festival.
That's awesome. He's like, I love this display.
They grow so fast.
Oh, God. Autumn was with me on the day we picked him up from rehab at the Raptor Center. So he was a really tough bird to train. I don't think I've ever had a bird teach me as much as this bird has taught me.
Let's not talk about it, okay?
I know she made a clicking sound when you're... Is that its cue that the food is coming?
It is a bridge to say, you're doing great. You're being super calm. You've definitely earned some food.
Oh, okay.
I would love to say it to him in owl, but I just have no idea how to say that. So we have, since I've known him, I've made that noise when I've delivered food to him. And so he knows that it's paired with food, like Pavlov
sure.
and his... You have dog in his bell there. Any other questions?
He's full.
There it is.
Owls have notoriously poor up-close vision. If you notice those long feathers by the beak, those are sensory feathers. So they can see really well in the distance, but once it gets close, they bring it up and just kind of rub it against their face. Oh, there it is. And then they just kind of bite randomly until they get it in their beak. So if he doesn't reach for the food when it's coming up to him, then I have to bring it up and touch his face with it. He's like, oh, food. I'm getting fed. That's okay. He's doing great. I couldn't be prouder of him.
He's come a long way.
Yeah, we have.
It looks like it has feathered feet.
Yes. Feathered feet for silent flight, extra feathered feet for living ridiculously far north. Boreal snowy owls take it to some amazing extreme. Autumn, do you want to dig through my bird biofactor I'm called a snowy owl foot to show people? Nothing changes. Yep, I haven't moved anything since she worked for me that many years ago.
So he's full grown now?
Full size. Now he's a male, so females are going to be just a hair larger in raptors. Girls are bigger than boys. We see the biggest difference in size in raptors that eat other birds for a living. So that's the occipiter hawks and the falcons. In some of the occipiter hawks, the females can be nearly twice the size of the males. However, these guys are rodent specialists, and there is more like a 10 to 15% difference in size rather than the near 100% difference in size. So he's a really big male. When I picked him up from the Raptor Center, the vet said, oh, this is definitely a male. We measure him tip of the head to the tail. If they're under 25 centimeters, something like that, Then they're a boy, and he was 24, one under, whatever the measurement was. But now when I bring him down, she's like, you know, I think this really is just a really small girl. I'm like, I'm not changing his name, just. Yeah, he's named Odin because he's missing an eye, and Odin is Norse mythology, a god who sacrificed an eye for the drink from the Well of Wisdom, which I thought was appropriate for an owl.
Jeff,
not that owls are wise.
Just
pass it around.
Okay. It's the banded one.
Yeah, so that, sadly, is my first ever snowy owl I saw in the wild. We know that because it's wearing a band. Not that I could read the band from the binoculars, but perhaps you saw one with black markings and the green wing tag. That was V66. She was a 5-pound female named Texas. I saw her in Superior, Wisconsin, down at the border with Duluth, right under the bridge. About 3 weeks later, we were picking up some dead animals from a rehab where we work with in Duluth. And my assistant was doing that for me, and she sent me a message and said, hey, if you ever want to see your first ever snowy owl again, it's in your freezer. It was pretty sad.
It's sad.
But, you know, it's cool because I got pictures that bird was alive. And, yeah. And I also have a mount of a northern hawk owl that Megan and Autumn and I saw when it was alive, and it died about 3 weeks later. That same rehabber called me, and she says, I got a dead hawk owl in pristine condition. I'm like, it's
no,
not from the dirt bag.
Please don't tell me about the
She's like, how did you know that? I'm like, hello.
Yeah,
and
it died.
It was with a dirt bag. First hawk owl I ever saw.
It was called the
dirt
factory.
I don't
know
what
it was. Yeah, but. So if there's ever another boreal owl that comes down and goes to a rehabber and cannot be put out in the wild, you know, would they become like native pairs?
There is amazing permits necessary to keep raptors.
Oh, okay.
And we have a permit for education. We don't have a permit for propagation or breeding. And so they typically won't place birds for breeding unless it's a conservation necessity. And boreal owls, I believe, are listed as least concern on the IUCN list. And part of that is being their population just isn't well understood because they live where we don't. But from what we can tell, they seem to be doing okay in the wild, at least from what we can gather from eruption years and the numbers that are moving.
Do raptors have crops like other fowl?
Say it again?
Do raptors have crops like other fowl that they need rock or any type of grinding material?
You know, they're generally ripping stuff up a little bit more than other birds. You will get imprinted falkons that do eat rocks. And I'll find rocks and occasionally in other pellets, but it's not something that they are renowned for doing like other birds. Other birds will. It's a good question. No, that's a frog.
I saw it right behind you. Sorry about
that. No, don't worry.
So when he's not on display, he's outside all the time?
Yep, he's got an indoor-outdoor enclosure. He usually spends at least part of the morning sleeping outside by his window, and then he usually goes inside and naps inside in the afternoon on top of his shelter box. And then overnight, he's just all over the place.
In the summer when it gets hotter, is that a problem for them?
Yeah. Most of my birds I have to deal with, oh, it's too cold, let's bring him in. Him, I have literally no concerns about the cold. I will bring every other bird in and just leave him outside. Negative 35, it doesn't matter. He's outside. He can handle it. But when it gets to be too hot, we provide him with piles of ice cubes to stand on if he so chooses, and maybe even set a fan up outside of his enclosure if it gets to be ridiculous. But he knows to sit in the shade, and he does some heat dissipation exercises as well. Owls will open their beak and breathe through their mouth, and that helps increase evaporative cooling like a dog does. So, haven't had any issues with him being overheated and is causing medical issues, but it is always a concern. Yeah, he's kind of a little bit different to manage, but he's a real nice species to have here because it's almost never too hot. Usually we have the opposite issue. So it's nice not to have to worry about that.
So what's the scientific name? I got you.
Agulius funeris.
Repeat that.
Agulius funeris.
Yeah, the funeris is a species name because they're named, they're nicknamed the funeral owl over in over in Europe. Yeah, I'll open my Audubon app here.
Same genus as the saw-wet.
Are they in the same genus as
yes.
Saw-wets?
Yes.
Yeah, it is. They're a little bigger than saw-wets. I do have a saw-wet mount on the back wall there across from the turtle if you
behind on the side.
If you wish to have the comparison.
We have them here too.
Yeah, A-E-G-O-L-I-U-S is the genus name, and the species name is Funeris, F-U-N-E-R-E-U-S. So we have about 10 minutes till lunch. Savannah, do you want to grab some rodent pellets and see if you can wake Spike up? And then anybody who's interested, this chain link enclosure out the back side of the barn is our porcupine enclosure. And Savannah will wake Spike up and you can see him. So if you want to see the porcupine, you can follow Savannah. If you want to get a closer look at the boreal, you can stay with me.
So how many times a day do you feed
him? Just once.
Just once?
Yeah, when I was doing more of his initial training, I'd probably do 3 to 5 training sessions with him. But now that he's trained and he's a really good bird, I just do it once. Sometimes I take him out. I've been putting him in a tree every day for a week, practicing in preparation for you guys. And then if I don't have a lot of time, then I just put food in there and let him rip up something.
Put that on my YouTube channel.
Great. Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.